for this time together. Thank you how you're using all different aspects of ministry all over the world. Asking right now your blessing on this time together. Please use it for your glory and our good. In Jesus' name, amen.
We have an indescribably, incomprehensibly great God who's looked upon a sinfully depraved people and sent a scandalously merciful Savior. And as a result, we have an indescribably urgent mission.
Brothers and sisters, we must sacrifice our lives and shepherd our churches to penetrate unreached peoples with the gospel, because we are convinced down at the core of our being that our God deserves the praise, not just of a few thousand people groups on the planet. Our God deserves the praise of all 16,000 people groups on this planet.
And it's worth it to represent this God and to declare His word. Is there anything more important to give our lives to than the representation and declaration of this God's glory to the ends of the earth? Whom shall I send and who will go for us? The Lord pronounces, Isaiah says. Isaiah rises up and says, here am I, send me.
That's a little bit where we've been the last 4 years, and we'll be getting a little bit more into that, of what we've learned, what God's, how God's been working through us as a family. You can come on up. She's part of this too. She does. We have her talk too, because you know she's prettier than I am. So we want to introduce you to our family, kind of in more detail. Oops, I need to use this. I asked for it, and I can use it. Maybe. Maybe you can drive it for me up there. There we go. All right. So that's our group. That's our family. I am surrounded by women in my life, but that's okay. Our oldest three have moved out of the house, kind of. Liz, our oldest, she is what we think is her last year at Liberty University. We've thought that for the last couple of years, but it continues to go on. She's on this 7-year bachelor program. But she has actually moved to Virginia, so she lives there full-time now, too. Kenzie, actually, Liz is studying child life specialist. Okay, so this is part of the problem. She wanted to be a nurse, then she realized she doesn't like shots, getting them, or administering them. So then she wanted to work with children in hospitals to kind of walk them through their illness and how to deal with treatments and things like that. So she's going to be a child life specialist at Liberty. Kenzie is in her final year at Spring Arbor University. That's in Jackson, Michigan, and she's studying to be sports medicine. She's had 5 surgeries on her 2 knees now, and through that process, she realized, hey, I want to be a trainer. So she wants to be an athletic trainer at a university. And Maddie just started her first year at Cornerstone University. She is a psychology major right now. That'll probably change, but that's where she's at right now. But she wants to get involved and work in working with children as well.
And then Savvy, she's not with us this weekend because she's actually at our church's winter retreat this weekend. So we're really excited for her to be there, making some friendships and some memories, and having, you know, the youth leaders pouring into her. But Savvy loves basketball, and she loves America. Like, she could not wait to get back to America. But now that we've been back for several months, Thailand is such a community-focused way of living. She's kind of, every now and then she's making comments, she misses the community of what life is like in Thailand. So now she's starting to talk a lot about getting back to her friends back in Thailand. So we're excited about that happening in her heart. That makes it easier. And then Kate, she can't wait to get back to Thailand to where the land of where everything matches. In Thailand, you just go with it. It's whatever you want, whatever you feel like putting on that day. That works really well for Kate. So kind of a little bit more rules here, so she can't wait to get back to that. But Kate is, her goal in life is to be a YouTuber. So she loves YouTube. She loves learning how to do different crafts, watching how they play with toys so she can go and play with her toys. So that's Kate's, what she's aiming for in life.
Well, I went too fast. Can you back me up one? Okay, so this is where we're at. The first thing I need to tell you, it's not Taiwan, okay? Lots of times, even we have supporting churches say, hey, Tim and Laura, they're in Taiwan. No, it's not Taiwan, it's Thailand. And if you don't know where Thailand is, we're right in the far north. So right where Myanmar, most of you might know that as Burma, and Laos come together, and we're right up there in the northern part of Thailand. It's a beautiful country. It's warm pretty much year round, so we enjoy that. We had to get used to wearing socks again when we came back to the States because we never wear socks over there. So that's where we're located in Southeast Asia. So we answered this a little bit. Why Thailand? There we go. Why Thailand? And to answer that, I have to back you up a little bit and tell you some history about me. Unlike Brother Mark here, I watched my dad when I was growing up, and I didn't want anything to do with full-time ministry. All right, so he was in it. I watched him in it. There were some fun things, but I knew one thing is I didn't want any part of that. So I grew up knowing I'll serve, but not full-time anywhere. So I went into the banking industry, and that's where I lived in that sector for about 15 years. But God started wooing me into ministry, and he was patient. I'm thankful for his patience, because I said no lots of times. First it went from, I don't want to, and then it went to, I would like to, but I don't have any skill sets that fit in missions, right? I'm in banking. I don't particularly love to preach. And I just, nothing fits.
He lived and breathed sports.
And I lived and breathed
everything.
Sports.
If you want to know any sports fact, somehow he's able to store all of that knowledge in his head.
Doesn't really serve a purpose, but it's there. And that was me. I'm a sports-loving banker. God, you know what? Where does that fit in Thailand? So I had that conversation with him for a few years. And then I met a missionary who was running a ministry in Thailand, and he wanted some help doing that. And it got to the point where God said, see, if you just say yes, I have a spot for you in Thailand. And that's what brought us to Thailand. I'm going to go to Thailand. We're going to run a sports ministry. And we were gung-ho. It took us not very long to raise support to get there. But once we got there, God started changing things for us. That ministry, we were there about a year and a half, and the door was starting to close on that ministry that we were for a variety of reasons, but we no longer were a part of that ministry. So now we're sitting there thinking, okay, God, I kind of started thinking through this. We've left our oldest didn't even go to Thailand with us. She stayed here in the States. And Kenzie's only there for 8 months, right? And then she went back. So, God, we've got kids in the States. We sold everything we had. We moved to Thailand, and now you close this door on us. Why are we here? So we started asking this question, why, a lot, and ourselves. Because we thought we had it all together, right? And we went to do ministry. God's going to bless us. It's going to be great. And we got there like, oh, this isn't what we signed up for. But God started taking us through a phase of, you know what? It is what I came to the realization of. You know, my sports ministry or my sports background, God used that sports ministry to get me from here to there. And once I was there, he said, okay, now you need to pay attention to what I really want you to do here. And it took me a while to figure that out. I'm a little thick-headed, so sometimes it, you know, God had to really work on me. And there's some lessons we had to learn, and we went through this phase of asking God why or what's next, why, what's next. And a lot of it was be patient. Go to the next slide. And then you just, I have up here two lessons, or the lessons from the two Johns. You want to talk about the John 13 one first?
Yeah.
Go for it.
So while we're sitting over there in Thailand, and just kind of being like, what are we supposed to be doing here now? I mean, we're here. And totally felt like this is still where we're supposed to be. God just really just started speaking to us, and I love the, like, the song this morning, like, just look in the Word. Just in his Word, just sharing, like, what is my commandment, my greatest commandment, is to love people. And so God just really started pressing that on us. I want you to see who I'm going to put in your life today. And when you see them, I want you to be ready to love them. And then we're kind of like, okay, like how? It's like, just be ready, and I'll let you know what that looks like. It's going to be different each time, but just, are you willing to obey me and be ready to do that? And so that's what we started doing.
And we quickly found that just by loving people, we have John 13:35 up here, you know, this is how you will know that you are my disciples and how you love one another, if you love one another. And that's what he was telling us. Love people and let them know, let them be drawn to me through that love. So that's what we said, okay, we can do that. But still, what's next? And I'm a big John Wooden fan. I love reading his books, you know, and some things have stuck out to me through the years, and a lot of the things is on what he says about learning. One of my favorite quotes of his is he says, it's what you learn after you know it all that matters most. And one of the other ones he said that he wrote in one of his books is, when you're through learning, you're through. And I thought, man, God, is that what you're trying to tell me through ministry too? You just need to keep learning. I'm not, or you're done here. So just keep learning. So we said, okay, what are you going to teach us? What do we need to learn these next couple of years before we have to head back to the States? And who do we need to love? Well, let me introduce you to Geet. It's spelled K-I-T, but it's pronounced G-E-E-T. Okay, I won't get into Thai language, but it's Geet. She worked in a bar. And a woman working in a bar in Thailand is, you know, you can imagine all the things that go on there. And it's even worse than what you can imagine. Well, her sister rescued her out of that life and brought her to live with her. Laura was friends with her sister, who's actually Laura's Thai teacher, her language teacher. And we started having them over for dinner, and Geet started asking questions like, why do they make us food? They're not our family. Or why do they do this for us? They're not our family. They shouldn't be taking care of us. And her sister said, well, because they love God, and that's what those people do. They love people. So this relationship started building with Geet. Well, Geet's sister took her through cosmetology school, I guess is what it's called, and she started working in a salon. Well, Geet is a tribal person. There's Thai and there's tribals, and there's a whole hierarchy of the Thais look down on the tribals, and she doesn't have citizenship in Thailand, so she's one of these stateless people there. So she was treated very poorly in the salon. They wouldn't let her cut hair. They said, you're only good for sweeping up and cleaning up and doing our dishes. So she told her sister, well, if they're going to treat me like this, I might as well go to the bars. At least I make money there. So her sister contacted us. There's anything you can do. She can't go back. She can't go back. So we asked her, what does she want to do? Well, she wants to cut hair. So, okay, well, let's help her start a salon. And this is kind of where the humor of God comes in, right? I'm a sports guy, and I end up in a hair salon, okay? So I spent time, I contacted a couple of business people over here. They sponsored her. We raised enough money to start this salon so she didn't have to go back into the barn. So I raised the money. Her and Laura spent the money building everything. And I got to the point she's ready to open. And I said, okay, but we need to, she didn't have much knowledge on how to run a business. So I went with her and said, okay, this is how we manage the money. This is how we need to buy inventory and keep track of all it. And so we're going through the business part of it. And then Laura would come alongside and start discipling through the book of Mark. And just started having those weekly talks with her. And then she started coming we go to a Thai church over there. So then we invite her to come to church with us. So she started coming to the church with us. And for the grand opening at business over there, they normally have the Buddhist monks come in and do a blessing on the shop. And we said, hey, you know, you've been coming to church with us. Can we have Pastor A come and pray a blessing? And she was excited for that. So we invited him. He came. Her family was all there. So her family heard the gospel at her grand opening from a Thai believer, which was great. So Geet has just been asking amazing questions. I don't know if you want to go into that a little bit. No? Yes? No? Okay.
It all started with just her being at our house and that Tim, like if we'd be sitting around the table talking, Tim would just start cleaning up the dishes, you know, and, you know, he'd take him to the kitchen, he'd start doing the dishes, and she just didn't understand that. And her sister's not a believer, but her sister knows what we believe. We've had lots of conversations, her sister and me. And so her sister's answer to all her questions is just always, they love God, and God tells them they're supposed to love people. Like, so that's why they do these things. She just always had so many questions about that. So when her and I are together spending money, she would just always ask me more. Like, I just don't understand those. So you love people, but I don't understand why. That was just, like, would try to answer, you know, and that was what got her to the church. I was like, well, maybe if you come, maybe they can explain it better in a way that you understand. And so she started doing that. But when COVID hit and church had to close, that's when I kind of reached out to her and said, you know, I mean, we can't do church anymore, but what about if we just meet one-on-one and we can read through the Bible together and you can see for yourself who Jesus is and what he says. And so that's when that started. But the pastor's wife kind of came with us because I knew we'd be leaving soon, so I wanted to have somebody to hand her off to and also just kind of help with translating sometimes. So that was going great. I mean, her questions, I tell you, I probably have grown more in love with Jesus doing a Bible study with someone who knows nothing about him because they see things I've been taking for granted for years. And, I mean, she just, things like, I mean, he just healed the people. I mean, he just said it? Yeah. But he didn't have to, like, it just says he just said, get up. I'm like, well, yeah, he just spoke. I mean, this is just blowing her mind. And I'm like, yeah, Jesus just speaks and it happens. And just his compassion for women. I mean, we kind of take that for granted living in America because women have rights. You know, we have freedoms. We're equal. We can vote. You know, everything. You'd put that in her culture, and especially her being a stateless person, Jesus' compassion, and what her job was in the bars, Jesus' compassion for women doing things that she did. I mean, she's just like, she's so drawn to him.
So she was one of the first people God put in our lives after he closed the door to the sports ministry. And we were like, huh, God's onto something. Love people, right? And for her, love was help her start a business and coach her through it and introduce her to other Thai believers. And the Thais are just drawn to love. And we're going to go into that a little bit in a second. So we're in this learning phase, and it's, okay, we thought we knew everything about Thai culture. I dove heavy into language, too, because I soon realized if I don't have any deep, meaningful conversations on campuses or with university students, I need to know more than just my communication tie that I knew. I really dove to get so I can get have deeper conversations with them. But one of the things that we learned were Thais are not Buddhist. Now, everything we read before going to Thailand was, you know, 95% Buddhist, and it's a Buddhist country, and that's true. I mean, that's an area right by outside of our house. There's Thai Buddhist wats everywhere, and there's statues of Buddha, you know, throughout the whole city. And if you were to ask them, they would say they are Buddhist. But what we realized is that really pertains to their spirituality and their eternity. They tie that all to Buddhism. But Thais are really, they really worship or are involved in three different religions, and then they kind of cloak it with Buddhism. For their everyday life, it's animism. They are freaked out of evil spirits. They have spirit houses outside their house, and they put food and drinks, and they burn incense. And their thought process is, if we appease the spirits outside of our house, then they won't come inside of our house. They'll leave us alone. And that, you know, that has nothing to do with Buddhism. That's just, they're scared of evil spirits. They're scared that they don't do enough to pray their family members out of hell and pray them into a better life after they pass on, that they will come back and haunt them. And so they just live in constant fear of evil spirits. The other thing they do is they're very superstitious. So karma is a big thing for them. And they'll have different gods that they pray to help them in that area of life. If they want kids, they'll pray to that god. If they want a successful business, they'll pray to that god. If they want health, they'll pray to that god. So they bring Hinduism into it as well. So as we're learning all this, and this is just talking to neighbors or talking to a Thai believer that, you know, came out of Buddhism or that life, we're like, whoa, I guess we don't have it all figured out. We have to really know how to communicate and reach and what stories of the Bible to use that will be more effective in reaching them.
Like, for example, John 3:16, for God so loved the world. Like, we think this is a great thing to communicate to people. But for them, because of all of the levels of gods that they believe in, love shows weakness in a god.
The higher the god, the less emotion you show.
The less emotion. And so for them, they're like, oh, okay, so your god
loves
the world. He must not be a very high god. So they're not very interested in him. So for God to love the world, he gave his only son. Okay, there's a son. That means there's a mother. What god is she? We need to make sure we're keeping her happy. How do we pray to her? What do we give to her? For God to love the world, he gave his only son. Whoever believes in him won't perish but will have eternal life. They're freaked out of eternal life. They live in fear every day of their lives. They want life to cease to exist.
So, well, the goal of a Buddhist is to experience nirvana, to have a state of no feeling, to be nothing.
So that's where the Buddhism comes in. The Buddhism is their eternity. They want to achieve that.
So
nothing.
Eternity freaks them out. You lead with that verse, and you've lost them. You know, you can't continue on until you start building more of a relationship. So we learned that the hard way. There's also goofy laws and just culture that we had to figure out. So over here, you see a motorbike is the primary source of transportation over there. And then you see this lady is holding an IV bag. Okay, so that's how they're getting around town. The law is she needs to have this helmet on.
The driver.
The sick lady holding an IV bag, she's good to go. Okay? So, and we've also seen like a whole family of five riding on a motorbike, but if the driver doesn't have a helmet, then you're going to have an issue. Same thing over here. This is how
we've seen where the driver is the one with the IV going into that.
Yeah.
But as long as he's got the helmet
he's
on,
good to
he's
go.
Good.
So here, if this were my truck and I weren't wearing a seatbelt, I'd get a 500 baht fine because I'm not wearing a seatbelt. But the 35 people in the back of my truck are okay. So that's just kind of how, you know, and you say there are options, the street signs there. In Thailand, they're just suggestions. So you really got to watch what you're doing. Some other things that we learned.
Electricians are in high demand. We don't know if that's because they're all getting fired because of the
shoddy
mess
work right there.
They're
yeah.
all leaving, or because
They die.
It's a high-risk job because they just kind of are up there shimmying and hanging on the wires. And
they get up there by a bamboo ladder. They lean the ladder on the wires. They climb up. Then they throw another rope over, and then they just slide over. I don't know what this guy is doing. He might just be there to scoop them up when they're done. But we took that picture. And what you can't see is they're all wearing flip-flops. So the OSHA-certified shoes for Thailand are Crocs and flip-flops. So this is a big lesson for us, honor and shame. Now that might not sound new if you're familiar with any type of Asian culture. It's an honor-shame culture. But what we didn't realize until we got there and just started living in it was how much it rules everyday life. It's just in everything you do. In your greeting, if you greet somebody the wrong way, you could totally offend them or freak them out. This is the why. They don't shake hands. They don't really touch much. They just do this, right? If I were to why a person younger than me first, if I go into a school and start whying kids, I'm cursing them to live a life, about 50% less than their normal expectancy.
You just cut
their life in half by just saying hello first. Because I didn't allow them to show honor to me as the older person. The higher up the face you go, the more prestigious the person you're whying. See, even Ronald McDonald gets it. He's got it down here, right? It's even in sports. It's in sports. You don't honor or shame, or you don't shame people in sports. So God closed the door for sports ministry when we were there, but he didn't take sports away, which it's kind of cool how he did that. I was able to still coach a girls' basketball team over there. And something that transcends culture is just my opposition to referees and officials, all right? I just have a fundamental difference of how they think. And I argue with them. Well, in Thailand, they won't say anything back. Like, we were at a tournament, and this girl dribbled out of bounds. So I told the ref, she stepped out of bounds, and he just went, they're fouling us. They just smile and nod, and that's just how it is. You just don't argue with them, and they're not going to argue back. And maybe they'll call it right the next time, but most of the times they don't because they're referees.
Oh, goodness, gift giving. It's an art, and it's a hard one to learn. There's a lot of rules that go with gifts, and if you know any Asians, you've probably been just dumped on with gifts. They give gifts like crazy. So we learned. You always have to be prepared to give gifts to people. Every time we go away, we need to be thinking of the people to bring gifts back to. So if we go
Or don't tell them you're going away.
Yeah, that's the easier thing to do. If we go to Bangkok for the weekend for a little vacation, we need to be bringing something back to give to our neighbors or to our kids' friends' parents to let them know that we thought about them. But it can't be too personal of a gift, because if it's too personal, then you've raised the status of your friendship, and then you always have to buy
Keep
a gift
there.
At that level, because at the next time, if I just buy them something, a magnet or something, that's not personal. Then they think they've done something to offend me, and I no longer want to be their friend, and so now they've been shamed, and they're embarrassed, and so then they just try to, disassociate themselves with me so that they are not shamed and embarrassed. But I brought you a magnet. I don't know. So keep it unpersonal, but it be something that they can use and let them know you thought of them, or just don't tell them you're going away.
Or don't tell them you're going away.
But they all know we're in America, so I know. I'm like, oh, I've got to find a lot of things to bring back.
Somebody tossed, you have to have a list of five. So the five people that you're closest with, and then there's five that go out from that, you're associated with. So. Yeah. Here's what we've learned that Thais do is if we go to a birthday party, they won't open the gifts in front of you. Number one, they don't want to show the wrong emotion. So if they get real excited for someone else's gift and they don't show excitement for yours, then they've offended you. So they won't open gifts ahead of time, which we fail miserably because our girls just tore in everything in front of everybody. But the other thing is they keep records. So if you go to a party and you give a gift, they'll write your name and what you gave so they can reciprocate, not too high or not too less based on what you give them, because they don't want to offend or make you feel
shame. So a girl that we had gotten to know, she was getting married, and we're like, okay, well, we'll give some money for them getting started. And thankfully, we had talked to someone before we gave them money, because they were like, well, what's their social status? And we're like, well, she's, you know, pretty poor, so we want to kind of help them out. They're like, no, if you give her too much, because she will keep track of that, when one of your kids has something of worth celebrating, they will feel that they have to give that amount to your kid, and it will be a stress and a burden to them. So it's like, you can't even like help people out because it's a burden.
So, you know, we just have to find unique ways to love them and show that we care for them and not have what they call grangjai and that sense of obligation to us as we interact with people. Share about Ploy.
Okay. Oh, so with the shame thing, it's just so much in every part of their life. So Ploy, we opened up our house to university kids to come in on Thursday nights. I'll make dinner, we'll help you with English homework, you know, and that turned into pretty much us, you know, we would do that, they'd stay and they'd hang out, we'd talk, watch movies, whatever, and then, you know, sometimes on Saturdays they're coming over and hanging out, but Thursday nights, you know, it's always open. So our one girl started bringing her friend Ploy with her, and Ploy just was drawn to Jesus, and she just kind of started asking questions. She wanted to know what Christianity is, what's Jesus, who is he? I don't want to be Buddhist. And so we were having a lot of conversations, and then we got to where I was like, okay, girls, who wants to, we can, you know, with COVID, when that hit, we can like start our own Bible study. Let's, you know, we can study through Mark together. And some of the girls like wanted to do that, and we were doing it individual. But Ploy, those girls were already believers. They were already followers of Jesus, but Ploy wasn't. Ploy really wanted to study the Bible with me, but because of shame, she wouldn't, because it was too embarrassing for her, for me to see how much she doesn't know. And so that would have been too shameful for her. And so she just kept, no, I can't, I'm busy, I have this. And finally it was one of the other girls that told me, Ploy wants to study so bad, but you know, shame, she can't do it. I'm like, oh my goodness. So the cool thing about that though was I told Phone, I'm like, well, then you start doing a Bible study with her. And she's like, I can't do that. I don't know everything. I said, what did you learn today? And she told me, I'm like, well, then you go teach that to Ploy. You just start reading through with Ploy, and what you learn, you share with her. And she's like, oh, I can do that. So it was really cool to see one of our girls start discipling Ploy. But then just recently, just last week, we've been messaging with them back and forth. Last week, Ploy started messaging me, and she said, they told me that if I don't get baptized, then
Jesus won't know me.
Jesus won't know me. Is this true? And right away, you know, I want to be like, no, that's not true. Who told you that? Oh, my goodness. And I was about ready to, like, hit send on that, and then I was like, wait. If I send her that message, it will be that shame, embarrassment, she would feel stupid that she didn't know that what that person told her wasn't true. So it was like a quick stop, delete, and go back through and just say, okay, well, how about you go, can you read this verse for me and tell me what you think this verse means? And so I just kind of started sending her into her Bible, just reading one verse at a time, and what do you think that means? What do you think that means for you? And so her just come into the realization, like, no, Jesus says, if I trust him and I, you know, if I, like, you know, first her going through, Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is God. You know, we kind of worked through that. And if she believes that and trusts him, like, that's salvation. And so it was really amazing. What morning did I wake up? Wednesday morning?
I think so.
Wednesday morning. So just this past week, Wednesday morning, woke up, and she finally said, you know, Jesus is enough for her, not just for afterlife. He's enough for her for this life, and she can trust him. And so she said, so Ploy is saved. So that was, like, amazing.
Yeah, that was the highlight of our 2021 so far. Yeah.
But just that shame, you just have to be careful of even how you you are communicating with them all the time, that you don't say something that will shame them.
We don't have time to get into the no thing, but ties won't tell you no. They'll just make excuses because they don't want to shame you. But so we're continuing to learn. There's lots more for us to learn over there. But now that we're kind of, God had us in that phase, what's next for us? And I call this the Go model. This is Go and his wife, Oi. Go is a owns a coffee farm on the mountain of Doichang. And about 2 years ago, he came up to one of my friends over there and said, you know, I really have a heart to reach the people in my village. He was living in Chiang Rai, but he wanted to go back and reach the people in the village of Doichang. And Nate said, okay, well, start a Bible study. Well, I don't know how to do that. Okay, well, we'll help you do it. So Nate and Go started this Bible study in his house, in his village of Doichang. And people started joining it. And it started growing and growing and growing. And it was just, we'll serve people, and then we'll have a Bible study. We'll serve people, have a Bible study. And that grew into, Nate said, Go, I think you have a church here. So they rented a storefront, and it started a church. They call it the Living Room Church. They call it the Living Room Church up there, or they call it something different. I forget what the translation is. But it's just pretty much a group of villagers that get together on Sundays. They study the Bible, and they look to ways to serve the community. And from there it grew. Go said, okay, well, as a church, let's start reaching out to the Buddhist schools in our village, and we'll offer them English. And then a youth group started out of that. And as I'm watching this unfold, and Nate's kind of experiencing it firsthand unfold, we're talking, and we're like, this is the next thing for us. When we get back, we're looking for, can you go back one more slide? I'm sorry, I must have, there we go. We're going to focus on a village that has little to zero church engagement, and we're going to zero in on them for 2 to 3 years. We want to find a national that's a believer that has a heart, that's living in that village, that has a heart to reach those people, so he can be there as our follow-up and our discipling as people are coming to know Christ. And we're just going to work with him to build relationships. So what does that mean for us? Well, Thai village, especially poor village schools that don't have access to English, they're drawn to white people because we speak English. So we'll go into the schools and teach English, offer sports camps. As teams come out, we'll do some sort of week-long Bible camp that involves sports. Poor villages, we can start up businesses and help them earn some money in their village. Really, anything that will be of value to the national that will help him gain credibility to the people in that village that we can reach them for the gospel. And the gospel will be at the center of everything. You know, we want evangelism to happen, discipleship. And if there's not a church, one planted, or to strengthen the local church that's already there. While we're doing all that, we don't want to lose focus of what God taught us through John 13, 34, and 35. We don't want to become too busy. We're not loving the people that God still puts in our lives every day, like Ploy and Geet, our neighbors that we started building relationships with, and continue to show God's love. Love people, and when they're drawn to him, show them how to do it so that they can reach their neighbors and friends for Christ as well. Anything you want to add to that?
I mean, that's like true for all of us. Like, we all have our everyday job, our career, or we're home with the kids. So our next ministry is, you know, going back and, you know, going into the villages for a couple years. But still, God's command is still, like, we're each supposed to don't miss who he's putting in our life any given day and what loving that person at that moment in time is supposed to look like. So
we're excited to get back.
That's for all of us.
Yeah, our plan is to be back in July as long as the country's still closed to people coming in. If I get the right visa type, I think we'll be able to get in, so we're working on that. Our goal is to be there in July, and then after we get the kids settled back in school, Nate and I are going to start figuring out the next village. We've got it narrowed down to two. One's about an hour and a half from where we live, so we'll be going in there a few days a week and figuring out what we can set up there. So the next one. So partners, we need them. And here's what we're looking for with our support team. We love it when you're engaged with what we're doing. That's our email up there. If you want to be, we send out a newsletter every month. So if you want to engage with us in what God's doing in our lives as a family, in the people that we're ministering to in Thailand, shoot me an email. We'll get you signed up for that. You can follow us on Facebook and Instagram and kind of get just up-to-date daily updates on what's going on with us and people that
and
we're
please,
interacting with.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Please do that. Friend request us. Some of my, like, greatest friends are, like, people from some of our supporting churches that we've just kind of gotten to know each other through Facebook over the years. So do it. Request us. And
come and see us. Get engaged that way. Get involved in the work that we have going on over there. We what we've got planned, groups complement that very, very well. And then that being engaged lets you know how to pray. You know how to pray for us, who to pray for. And we need financial support as well. We are a little short monthly, and we have some expenses going into Thailand now that have, the government has changed some rules, so it's going to cost us almost $10,000 just to get in the country as we go back, COVID-related stuff. So you can be praying for that too. We need to raise that. And that, we have a few minutes for some questions. We kind of dumped a lot on you.
Yeah, so Mark was written to the Gentiles, so who didn't know any of the Jewish rules or anything like that. And so for them, like, they don't know, they don't have that base knowledge of God in the first place.
They don't know anything. I mean, so they don't have any Old Testament history. So let's just introduce them to Jesus, and let them fall in love with him. And Mark's a great book of them seeing who he is.
This is how Mark talked to people who didn't know who God was, then I'll trust him.
And then things
I'm not going to reinvent
there,
the wheel.
Yes and no. So some of the men are just, okay, she said, the question was, a lot of our stories that we're excited about were
with women,
girl stories. Yeah. And are there stories that we have with young men? There are some. I was discipling a young man named M who, grew up in a children's home. So he got saved at a young age, but there's discipleship breakdowns.
Yeah.
There isn't really any there. So you get saved, and then, okay, now you just have to follow all these rules of, you know, that God tells us how to live, and there's really no discipleship. So I've met with M and just kind of going over, you know, what's it mean to live a life that God calls us as men to live? And he asks great questions, and he asked questions, like one of the questions he asked me was, P. Tim, my girlfriend's not a Christian, is that a problem? And I said, well, let's just, you know, walk through some of that. And we talked through some of the challenges he might have if, you know, as they get older or pursue the relationship. But I said, here's this thing, Em, just share God with her, you know? That, and then the problem goes away. If she becomes a follower of Jesus, then, you know, it's not an issue. He goes, oh, I can't do that because I don't treat her very well and I don't think she'll want to be a Christian. I said, okay, Em, that's the problem. We gotta take some steps back. But a lot of men that aren't believers yet aren't receptive to it because of that honor shame thing. They don't wanna be told that they're living the wrong way, or they're too embarrassed to admit their mistakes, so they don't wanna lose face with me. But some of the younger students are becoming more receptive to that.
But that was a good point. Having daughters, our kids have been our biggest connection to people. So it's, and that's a lot of why, like, the university girls would just, like, stay at our house longer, because they would just stay and hang out with our daughter Maddie, and, you know, they would go start doing things together. So our kids are a huge, huge part of just being able to connect with people. So
girls are more honest than guys are over there too.
They're very honest.
They're very brutally honest in some
They won't tell you no, but they will be honest if they're just speaking.
That's a miracle.
Yeah, so God kind of took care of all that ahead of time. Our little corner of the world that we're in, there's a international Christian school that they go to. So it's really cool how that's been set up for us. So it's harder than the schools are here. But
that was our biggest culture shock, an American-run school over there, just because it's American-run, it goes by American curriculum and everything, but very Asian mindset of
study.
There should
study,
be a
study.
Lot of homework every night. Yeah.
But they have a school that they can go to, and it's a blessing, and they get all types of culture there. I mean, there's students from all over the world that go there, so it's really cool. Any other questions? One of the most effective stories for us is Jesus's control over demons. So we use the stories of him casting demons on, just telling the evil spirits that, leave.
Let's go.
Yeah, getting those pigs and are off a cliff, and they are just drawn to that. Then they're like, well, who is this Jesus that he has this power over them? So we share a lot of stories like that.
Boy, this has been so good.
Good.
We're going to have lunch with the mission committee is going to have lunch with them, and looking forward to just our time together. But it's just been good. You've been such a challenge to us, not just in educating us on this, but challenging us that we need to have this heart in our neighborhoods again. It's always just another reminder that what works in Thailand works here too. And we can get so lazy where we're at and forget those neighbors that are right there that God has placed us with to love. So would you pray for us as we close this time?
You and that they'll know, the community will know that, hey, there's something different about these people, and we want it. So I just pray that they'll love people, Lord, and that your message will be irresistible to the people of this community here, Lord, and that you'll bring people to them. Thank you for the encouragement that being involved in this morning service has been to us, Lord, and we enjoy telling your stories. So thank you for, the opportunity for us to do that, and we pray that we'll be an encouragement to the people here as well. Thank you for loving us, God. Thank you for letting us be a part of your story.